Image projection is such an interesting and slightly weird lighting technique. In this 30-minute tutorial, we'll learn how to use it in Blender to generate pretty exciting multicolored light patterns, both static and animated. We will start with a really simple example and only then we'll try a bit more complex one. Don't worry if it won't give you the exact same result, there will be the blend file available with the final result to check, and anyway, some techniques just don't give identical results. With that out of the way, whenever a flat image is mapped onto some kind of a 3D surface, it is called image projection. This flat image could be projected from a spotlight, for example. It can be a static image or an animated sequence, it doesn't really matter. Projection carries the color of the source image into the scene and burns this texture onto everything it touches. The whole lighting setup could be built from multiple layers of projection. This technique is quite effective in what it does, yet it is balanced by some, let's say, randomness of the process. You get what you get. Sometimes it is awesome, sometimes not as much. I promise it will be interesting to try anyway, so let's just get started. I propose to start with setting up a basic projector in cycles. Really basic stuff to familiarize ourselves with the technique. I'll go Shift-A to add a plane first. This will be our floor. We can make it bigger like that. Then the spotlight will be needed, as it's the most straightforward way of projecting a pattern. So adding in a spotlight and placing it like this so it projects the light from the top. I'll change the viewport mode to rendered right away so we see what we are doing. Projection only works in render anyway. In the environment tab, let's put 0 in the environment strength, or maybe 0.1 to see the faint glimpse of the scene. Then with the spotlight selected, it would be fantastic if we could come over to the light settings. The power obviously will affect the strength of our projected texture, so let's make it really bright for the preview purposes, something like 10k watts. These values don't mean anything specific without context, it's just 10k of something. Don't pay attention to it. We'll need one more window for materials, so click and drag the corner of the window and then click here to open the shader editor. Our spotlight will have its material with nodes and all that stuff, so click use nodes. It has the emission node now with just two inputs. Strength and color. With this shader selected, Ctrl+T to spawn the necessary nodes, image texture itself, mapping and texture coordinate nodes. You'll need the node wrangler add-on for this shortcut to work though. The magenta is a signal that the texture cannot be found or missing, so now I'm gonna click open and give it some image. Images that I'm using here can be found in the downloads of the course for this tutorial. These amazing Night City photos are from Pixabay and on Splash, I believe. There is also a video there from pexels.com, if I'm correct. In case you don't see the thumbnails, just click here. The texture used for projection can be anything. I'll start with the first one though. And hey, where is my projection? The thing is that texture coordinate should be normal, not UV. And now it is something. But why it is so misplaced like that? Without going into mapping details, it is fairly easy to fix. First, it's easier to see what's going on by clipping the texture. You can find the clipping settings here. Boom, now it's clear that its location should be offset somehow. Then offsetting it by 0.5 on both X and Y. 0.5 should fix it. It has been centered, but still we cannot see the full projected image. Why is that? Within the spotlight settings, there's one setting called spot size. It controls how much of the image the projector actually shows. If we set it higher, it should reveal the whole texture eventually. So something like that. Well, now we have another problem to solve. By default, projected image comes out slightly distorted. It shows this cushion distortion. Fortunately, it's also an easy fix. I borrowed this one from CG Matters tutorial. I see you matter. What we have to do is make some room for additional nodes, then separate the x, y and z channels of our normal vector. Like that. Then add the mix node, mix color, and set the mode of this node to divide. I have no idea why, just like CG matter, to be fair. Then the normal vector should be divided by that z coordinate. Without going into details, this little math trick just straightens up the image so it becomes nice and square. To adjust its orientation, we can either rotate the spotlight on the z-axis by hitting R for rotation and then z, something like that, or better yet, it can be adjusted from within the mapping node itself. So let's go into Shader Editor, just tidying up the nodes ever so slightly. So its position can be shifted horizontally, like that, with the help of the X axis, and vertically as well with Y. I doubt you'll need it, but just in case. Most importantly though, is that its rotation can be adjusted from there by tweaking the Z rotation. And lastly, the scale can be adjusted as well. As the original image wasn't square, tweaking either X or Y should allow us to nudge it closer to the original aspect ratio. It is perfectly fine to eyeball it. I thought I would mention it anyway. Some things just don't have to be precise. For now, I'll leave it as it is though. A square. Okay, now I'll click and drag the selection rectangle around all of these nodes, including our texture, and we'll go Shift-P to draw a nice frame around it. Now in the right tool shelf, where is it? I'm going to navigate to the Node tab and write texture in its label field. So far so good. That's how we set up a basic projector, and oftentimes it's more than enough. Next we'll go deeper and enhance this basic setup with the extra set of color grading controls. Usually when setting up projectors, it's useful to be able to nudge the color palette one way or the other. For that, we will need to add a few nodes. But first, I will introduce a few more objects to our scene to see how our projector interacts with 3D geometry. Just for fun, in other words. So let me add in a sphere, then Shift-D to duplicate it a few times, G to move, S to scale. That looks fine. The texture emitted by the spotlight interacts with everything in 3D world, and it's really interesting to play with it. I find this process to be really cool. One thing I forgot to mention though is that the radius in the spotlight settings affects how sharp or blurry is our projection. If we set the radius higher, it blurs the texture and vice versa. It's kind of important. The spot size, as we've mentioned before, allows us to shrink or grow the spot. That will come in handy later on when we will be reproducing this effect in the real scene. So this is how we shrink or grow it, and to make the edges smoother we can use the blend slider. Usually it's a good idea to give it at least some fall off. This way it doesn't look as jarring and it blends smoothly with the environment. Now let's try a different image just for fun, to keep it fresh. How about 01_3? Alright, I'll move this group of nodes to the left to free up some space, and we'll start working on color grading options by introducing the Hue Saturation Value node first. We can drop it straight on the line to insert it in between these two nodes. Saturation makes colors more vibrant, or on the contrary, tilts it towards a black and white picture, which could be useful. The hue, like, shifts all colors through the color wheel, and value makes it brighter or dimmer. Then the mix node could be very useful for color grading as well. Usually it's either in multiply mode or color mode. It lets us mix it with a certain color. like to make it cooler if it's blue, or do any other tone adjustments like that. The color mode, although it is pretty hard to describe it, but it replaces the original one with the selected color, which has utility as well. The factor is controlling the amount of the mix. We are almost finished. The last one that I'll add is RGB curves. Shift A, drop it here. RGB curves can be used to shape the overall contrast. For example, you can darken the dark tones and brighten up the bright areas. And of course, given how projection works, it means that if the color becomes pure black, it doesn't get projected at all, if that makes sense. There is no such thing as black light. So it disappears from the image. Projector ignores the values below the certain threshold, below black. From that perspective, implementing, let's say, the S-curve and generally tweaking the contrast is pretty useful in projection. Gonna draw a frame around them, around the color grading nodes, and give it a nice name to keep it tidy. Color grade. And that's it for this block. This is a minimal amount of color grading nodes that will suffice for what we're gonna do. It would be a shame if we didn't take our own advice from the previous set of videos and didn't try to HDR-ify the texture used for projection. By HDR-ifying, I mean of course taking the most luminous bits and making them emit an enormous amount of light. The thing is, often the strength slider in the emission shader is not enough. It's not enough to uniformly make the whole thing more powerful. It's more realistic to make only the brightest bits more powerful. I'm going to move the light output to the right. Okay, now let's go Shift A, shader, mix shader. Drop it here to connect it. Shift D to copy the emission as well. Then reconnect the inputs like that. And it goes into the second socket of the mix shader. What we need to do now is mask out the brighter parts. Color ramp should be okay for that. It requires an input, so, and it will serve as a mixing factor in the mix shader. The second shader needs to be much, much stronger. We can multiply it by a factor of 200 and it'll work great. To isolate the parts that are closer to the high end of the range, we need to first give it a proper name, of course. Just kidding. It's not that important probably, but not for me, not for me. I tend to classify and name everything. What we shall do now is move the black flag to the right to leave only the most luminous spots in the mask, so only they are supercharged with the high dynamic range. In fact, the first chapter from this update to cinematic lighting course has a detailed rundown of all the elements of this technique, explained in an easy to understand way. I cannot recommend it enough. If you missed it, it's a good opportunity to hit pause, brew yourself a nice cup of coffee or tea, and just check it out. It will make me happy and will help you to master this lighting, or is it shading, technique. The ad is over, we're back in business. This is it for HDRization, I think. We covered all the basics. The second emission, just a quick reminder, is our multiplier that usually has to be set pretty high. The benefit of doing it like this is that now each and every light spot of the projected textures effectively becomes a light source. And as a light source, it emits rather sharp light in this case, casts shadows and does all the beautiful ray tracing stuff. Feel free to play with the position of the spotlight, or with the angle of the spotlight, because a lot depends on these things in projection. I wanted to show a really nice technique for adjusting the angle of the spotlight. 3D cursor can be used as a pivot point for the spotlight. You have to press dot on the keyboard and go 3D cursor to choose it as a pivot mode, then select the spotlight, shift and right click places the 3D cursor, then you can hit R for rotation, and our spotlight will be now orbiting around the 3D cursor, which is quite handy. That is often how I orient and adjust the angle of projection. I thought it would be handy for you as well. I named these two emission shaders SDR for standard dynamic range and HDR for high dynamic range to differentiate between them. The SDR one is kind of our base level, and the HDR one once again controls how bright our extremes. Let's take one more look at the whole projection setup that we have just created. We have a bunch of nodes that control the texture. Then a few color grading nodes over here. And a special mention of RGB curves as our means of applying contrast. And then we have this setup for HDR-ifying the final result, to extend the capabilities of projection and be able to produce sharper highlights and all that stuff. All this sweet stuff. That is pretty much that's needed for the static projections. Still, it can be more. It can take videos as input. And that's what we're gonna be talking about for the next few minutes. The major part of the appeal of projection is actually being able to use animated footage for projection. Videos! Let us scroll back to the beginning of our spotlight material and find the source. Okay, that is the source. It can be a video or a sequence of images. Feel free to locate this MP4 file in the resources and give it a spin. The type should be set to movie, otherwise it won't work. It can be found here. The number of frames should be set manually. I'll type in 600. 600 frames. Then tick cyclic, and most importantly, auto refresh so it updates in the viewport as soon as we hit play. This is it, the video projection is ready. You can test it by holding shift and right clicking in the timeline zone to scrub through the animation, to see moving traffic in the video and other cool stuff. It's useful even for the static renders, as we can choose the frame that has most appealing combination of colors, textures, and so on. It is especially interesting with HDRization technique that we have implemented. It works really great, even though a bit random. Randomness, in my opinion, is a part of its charm. The ever-changing stream of colors is not easy to work with, but give it a chance and you'll love it. Don't forget about the HDR multiplier. Try different values, see how the lighting responds to it. It could look very different with the strength of 1 and let's say 200. The whole lighting calculation stuff depends on it. Each scene calls for its own range, so take some time and just test it out. Then each footage calls for its own contrast and color tweaks as well. Often I crunch the dark tones to isolate the highlights even more. We can do it in the RGB curves node. Alright, that was the basic projection setup in Cycles. This spotlight deserves a promotion. Let it be called Projector from now on. It's not just some measly spotlight, it's now a fully-fledged projector. Sounds gorgeous. Woo! We have just watched the first part of the video. Take a short break. This is not the end yet. In the next video, we'll take what we learned about projection and we'll try it on a real example to create a moody yet eye-catching traveling light texture. So feel free to take a short break and then go to the next video.